Welcome, Coleman Report Live, January 17th edition, SBA shutdown week four. Kim Willis, president of Ameritrust out of Seattle. Kim, thanks for joining us. She's going to talk a little about 504. And Brent Cherlino, senior advisor, network. You're also on the board, aren't you, on that? New Tech Small Yes. Business Finance. Yeah. Correct. Brent, former director, Office of Credit Risk Management, Okrum, SBA. Brent, we always enjoy you joining us. Let's start with you, Brent. Sure. What's going on?
Well, I think kind of talking from Okrum, give you everyone a little background. Okrum does have the ability to use what's called Know Your Money. So the review schedules are all being evaluated. So everyone that's been notified for reviews or think that they may be getting a par or a target or an on-site review, SBA is currently working to try to figure out, I believe, what they're going to do about those scheduling issues. I do know that they probably will have a challenge with the shutdown and putting personnel from SBA onto the review, so that may impact the on-site review schedule, but they, I think, are trying to work on a way, being that they have Know Your Money, to do PARs and target reviews. So I'm sure, not speaking for them, of course, I think they're working to try to figure out how to get information out to the lenders so that they can help educate them as to what the review schedule and timing is going to be as a result of the shutdown.
Brent, do you see them calling back some people and classifying them as essential since the lenders are paying for these reviews?
I think what they're doing right now is calling back a few people so that they can evaluate how to deal with the impact of the shutdown. So yes, I do think they're going to bring a few essential people in to come up with some solutions for, so they stay on target with their review schedule for the year.
Brent, what was your personal experience in previous government shutdowns when you were at SBA?
Well, usually one or two people in Okrum are deemed essential. And the other thing that we did back in the, you know, Gene Hewlett days and such, was we were able to make sure that there was a kind of allocation of Know Your Money. And Know Your Money meaning, and if you see some of the shutdown stuff, Know Your Money meaning that certain tasks in Okrum can continue to be done not on appropriated funds. It's mostly the oversight part, but my experience is that we structured it so Okrum could continue to do essential services itself because they had Know Your Money options or availability.
Good. Lance Sexton, former SBA out of Little Rock. What was your experience during previous shutdowns, Lance?
Well, this one certainly lasted longer than the two that I was part of. And, you know, one of the things that my experience, we had contractors at that time, and Brent probably remembers when we had contractors as a result of ARA. So when we did come back to work, we had more hands on deck to get caught up. I don't think, Brent, and you might correct me if I'm wrong, there's that group of contractors is no longer there.
The firm, I will say this, the firm is still engaged. Now, how they tap it, I'm not sure. But, yes, they changed the ability to tap that contract.
But it certainly helped in the servicing center when we did come back to work to get back on track. Brent knows how important it was for me for us to get our servicing actions done in 3 days. So it was good to have contractors, but this one's a different animal. I'm hoping they go back to work soon.
Kim, let's bring Kim into the conversation. Kim, 504 world, how is the shutdown impacting CDCs nationwide?
Well, it is definitely impacting us, Bob. It's not pleasant. I think that most people in the CDC industry have been through this before, although this is a record breaker for sure. And even some in past that maybe we just ran out of funding, so we would know come 10-1, the new year, we would have funding again. So there was a little bit of hope in there, and this one's a little mysterious as to when we're going to get back to work here.
What are you telling your borrowers? Or your potential borrowers?
Yes. We are really working closely with our borrowers and lending partners because this is devastating event for them. Here in Seattle, we have real estate that's crazy. And when people are missing close dates, you know, there's 5-6 people waiting in line to buy that property. So we're trying to work with the buyers, sellers, bankers, and just encourage them to give us a little time. We are working through new loans as they come in, getting them through our loan committee, et cetera, having everything ready to submit to SBA when they open. But it's a balancing act with trying to make people feel okay in the environment we have, but also providing some realistic measures.
Yeah.
If I could chime in, Kim and Bob, I've been chatting with some of the third-party lenders who are trying to come up with constructive bridge loan options for their borrowers, people like CIT, Bank of the West, Wells. I think they've been, some of the board members on the CDCs have been chatting to try to really, assist what Kim's referring to, which is providing options to give some comfort to those borrowers that are stranded out there.
One of the things we're going to be talking about later are those bridge lenders. Brent, I don't have those on the list, so if you would let me know those and next week, we'll go ahead and put those up as well. But what about the concept of a bridge loan, Brent? How's SBA or Lance or Brent, I'll do that. You know, all of a sudden now we're at same institution debt. SBA's always frowned on that. How do you think SBA is going to react to those type of bridge loans?
I don't want to speak for them, but I think one thing that SBA has always been is true to the borrowers. I mean, yes. They really are. They care about the borrowers, and we have many discussions behind the scenes during a shutdown about how we're going to mobilize when the doors open back up. I think some of the third-party lenders are going on the faith of that consistent commitment from SBA and are doing things that may be, quote, not, you know, authorized, but they're really trying to help the small business borrowers and have that faith that SBA will be there when they open back up to appreciate what they did. So I'm going to give SBA a big up on that.
You know, Brent, I really appreciate you saying that because I agree with you. You're both former SBA bureaucrats. Your heart's in the right place. Most of the people there are. Lance, what's your take?
Oh, SBA, just like Brent said, is always has the small business at heart. And I don't think they're going to penalize a bank that does an interim loan with the intent to take it out with an SBA loan. I do think it's important to note that the bank clearly puts in the credit memorandum that's the intent of this interim loan and structures it properly. Don't go out and do a 10-year maturity on an interim loan and then expect to take it out with an SBA loan. You still need to follow the guidelines in the SOP 5010-5J as best you can. But I do believe that, just like Brent said, SBAs, they're going to flex a little bit to make sure that small businesses.
That's great advice for the industry. I agree with you. I don't see SBA taking a position to penalize the lender for doing the right thing. And that's what lenders are trying to do in terms of doing
I don't want to speak for Kim because she's on the front line. It's really affecting 504. And just to make this happen through some of the bigger institutions, the small business third-party lender teams have to go to their risk departments and say they're going to be doing certain things that are outside the risk band in order to accommodate these small businesses. So everybody up and down the line, I think, and Kim can talk, are trying to help and going up against your risk department at this time to do something that's a little out of the box.
Yeah.
For the right reason.
What are you experiencing out there in terms of those bridge loan type of discussions?
Well, you know, I think we have had some active communication with our third-party lenders in that regard, and they are all very willing. They are familiar with the bridge financing concept anyway, with the 504, so this is just taking it a bit of a step further in that they have to do it without an SBA authorization, but they're familiar with verbiage that would make it eligible and stay eligible, and you know, we're communicating with them and seeing if they're okay with trying to make something like that work. And, you know, most really want to help the small business owner and have some faith that this won't last forever.
Hey, Brent and Kim, thank you so much for joining us. We've enjoyed the conversation. Always appreciate your insights. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Hey, let's, while they log off, let's go to the poll questions. And we have a couple of them here. And let's go to the first poll question, which is, SBA requires an annual site visit for loans over $350,000.
It's kind of a tricky question you're asking there, Bob. And the SOP...
It's not tricky. It's either yes or no.
I want to see the responses.
I think
there certainly is room for mixed results here, Bob. The SOP does not dictate a site visit specifically except at the time of origination and the time of default. However, there is some language about site visits that talks about prudent lending standards. So if your institution would do an annual site visit on a loan over 350 that's not SBA, then you better be doing it on your SBA loans.
Very good. Very good. And we bring that up. It's a prudent lending standard. And Lance, I appreciate you hammering home that. If you're doing it on your non-SBA loans, you got to do it in SBA. And you should. You should go out there and be talking to your people anyway. So good. Good response. Number two, SBA updates your PARIS score during the shutdown.
This is a tough one. We should ask Brent this one.
We should have asked that because I don't know the answer. Brent, go ahead.
I would say pursuant to the LLMS, that the system is still working. So you can go to your portal and get it, and the LLMS system is still online and working. So I'm going to say true because that contract is with Know Your Money.
Good. Thank you for that. I didn't know the answer to that. So that was my question.
I'm a strange SBA lender. I look in the PAIR score drop downs frequently. You know, I tell everybody you can go in SBA one, click on your PAIR score in the upper right hand corner, and then you can get some drop downs. I can see change in there. So it is active. So I'm going to say true as well.
Lance, there's someone on this call who doesn't know what we're talking about. Explain what PARIS is and why it is so important for the lender.
Well, it's just a measurement of how SBA looks at you as an SBA participant lender. And, if you have, there's different ways to access it, but the easiest one, if you have SBA 1, if you just pull it up, look at the top to the right just a little bit, you'll see your score. Click on that. It'll bring the five different areas of measurement, and within those, there are three or four in each category. If there is a blue colored descriptor, you can click on that and dive even deeper and see the loans that are impacting your score in a positive or negative way. But it's important because it's something SBA looks at renewal time for your delegated lending authority. I'm pretty certain it's something that SBA looks at in terms of frequency and types of review that you get as an SBA participant lender. So every SBA lending institution needs to know what their score is, and not just know what their score is, Bob, but know the information that impacts the score.
Hey, Brent, I know there's some lenders on the call who don't have access to SBA 1 or the score. Are they able to sign up for that during the shutdown?
They should be already signed up in their portal. So their portal is still active, and that's where they need to go. And there's all new features, again, that I think you guys have covered in some of your webinars about going to the portal to get those downloads. There's a lot of new good features, and it's very interactive. You don't have to actually reach out to Oakram anymore. You can go right to your portal. And the portal's up and operational.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Yesterday, I did a webinar, Lance, and I did a webinar on financing child daycare centers. It was a lot of fun. And we'll throw this out to you. What do you think child daycare industry revenues will be over the next 3 years? Up 10%, between 5 and 10, less than 5, or they will decrease? Go ahead, Lance.
Well, yesterday, Bob kind of tricked me on this one. I answered the question, but then... we had some additional feedback. the child daycare industry, one of the takeaways from the webinars, guy, one of the metrics that Bob presented was the success rate by virtue of showing how many business loans defaulted and how many charge-offs occurred in the last 10 years in SBA lending. And boy, the performance of the daycare industry, in particular franchise daycare industry loans, was unbelievably outstanding.
Yeah, very, very nice metric. The answer is, put that back, Joseph. The answer is less than 5%. The takeaway is child daycare industry revenues match GDP, and that's it. And so we're looking at 4% increase over the next couple of years. But the takeaway for that is when you're looking at this particular niche, assume that it's going to go with GDP. What that means is if we go into recession, that also these revenues will also decrease. So that was the takeaway. So,
well, and the other great thing, Bob, is these types of statistics are really important when reviewing the projections a small business presents. If you've got a daycare in year one and year two, they're projecting 50% growth, that's not in line with the industry standard.
Right. Let's go to some stats. We put these out on Monday. I'm not going to read them all. They're on our website. But Brent, the numbers are pretty devastating.
Oh, the shutdown impacts?
Yeah.
Yes. Well, yes, and I mean, it just starts stacking up. So, you know, what's going to be challenging is the lenders are going to have to, you know, multitask, which is they're going to have to deal with whatever their review stuff is. They're going to have to start to deal with the borrowers, and then they have new people coming in. So it's really, I'm surprised there hasn't been more of a story with the subcommittees, you know, pointing this out on the Hill.
Well, I know Kim was talking. She's talking to Senator Cantrell, who's on the Senate Small Business Committee. I believe she still is. But now we're starting to get stories every day about how this is impacting small business. The Washington Post is running articles, Wall Street Journal. So this is going to become more and more mainstream media of how this is a negative impact for Main Street. Were you able to talk to Senator Cantrell, to Kim?
Well, I was able to talk to one of her aides and explain to them the effects of this, you know, long shutdown. And, you know, I think they're sympathetic to a point.
No, I'm sure there are. I mean, everyone, this is a bipartisan issue. Everybody wants it done, but none of us in our corner of the world has any say over it. So I think, you know, we're all 100%, yeah. We want SBA to open, you know.
As right.
Brent, Tom has a question. Says, I'm a CLP lender, but I want to do a bridge loan, but my legal counsel advises me against it because it says that may hurt my POP application. I know you don't talk for SBA, but.
No, I don't see where that's going to hurt your POP application.
Yeah, I know your counsel's being conservative, Tom, but again, go back to what Brent and Lance and Kim, you know, are saying. SBA has the borrower's interests at heart, and they're not going to be punitive to the lender who's getting capital out to Main Street.
Yeah, and they have precedent and you know, and track record in backing the lenders. Lenders are really carrying the water at the moment for everybody, and that's because they feel confident that SBA will be behind it when they open back up. So this is a true case where, aside from all of our differences, everyone's aligned in the same direction. A big up to the lenders and a big up to SBA for
I do not see any lender being hauled before the House or Senate and being questioned. Why did you do bridge loans for Main Street when the agency was closed? That's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. So. Very good.
Well, was it a POP loan he's talking about, Bob?
No. They have their CLP license.
And they're trying to get a POP designation.
And they're concerned that they do bridge loan funding, that'll be an adverse impact on the POP.
I don't think so.
Yeah, all of our professional opinion is no, you're going to be fine. Hey, these are 10 things that we came up with yesterday that you can do during the shutdown. I'm not going to read them all. They're up on the website. But number one were site visits. Lance and I are big on doing site visits. Now's the time to go through and review your files, get your annual statements. Also, the advantage of the site visit is find out how your borrower is doing. Lance constantly preaches this is the year of servicing. And also further lending opportunities.
Well, and the other thing, Bob, is, and I know everybody's doing this, but it is an opportunity. You can just collect as much information as necessary to be ready to close. So when SBA goes back to work, you can sit down at your desk with E-Tran or SBA 1 and put all those POP and Express loans in, and you'll be ready to close in a day or two instead of putting it in, getting the number, then collecting the information. And that's kind of the way we're approaching it. I've got 10 loans right now stacked up that are all either POP or Express loans, and we're just getting them all ready, Bob, for the day when SBA goes back, and we just jump in the system, get an SBA loan number and authorization, and we're ready to go.
Brent, number 8, give some advice to lenders out there. How specific should they be on their SBA underwriting credit box? What, when you were at Oakrum, what did you want to see the lender have in writing when you guys walked in through the door?
I think two things are important right now. One is that they document the cash flow and the cash flow projections and the basis for those cash flows. Also, another thing is if you're dealing with a credit elsewhere issue right now, monetize what the difference is for a credit elsewhere situation. So if you say that a given loan has, the industry would do a 5-year loan with a 5-year AM, but you're going to do a 10-year and the difference in the payment is $1,000, you need to monetize and show that. But mostly have your support for your projection and your underwriting assumptions. And
Bob, and something Brent said, and this is something we talked about yesterday when we talked about credit elsewhere, you know, one of the things that's going to get you dinged when SBA comes in and looks at a file is if you've got this standard sheet that says credit elsewhere is met by check. You know, you need to customize your credit elsewhere response with each loan that you're working on. This is an opportunity to go back into your files that may not be robust enough in terms of documentation on credit elsewhere and fix them.
Yeah.
And you can either do an addendum or an appendix and couch it under internal review, internal control review. And that's a thumbs up when Oakrum comes out to do a review, whether it's a target or a site.
Yeah. And there's nothing wrong with documenting a year later and say, hey, this is what we determined and data. So, hey, we're going to update this, but I know Fountainhead, Kim mentioned, is doing bridge financing. New England Certified Development and Business Loan and Lindustry also sent us an email on that. We'll update that for next week. But I love the advice that Kim said is let's start talking for the 504 lenders. Talk to your third-party lenders and what their appetite is to be able to do that. Right, Kim?
Right.
Great. And don't forget those non-bank lenders that are trying to do 504. They're helping out too, and they don't have the same restrictions.
Can you name one?
Absolutely.
New tech. Very good. Hey, let's go to the questions. Paul asked the question. Paul, Brent, and Kim. Paul's our resident question guru. Lance, go ahead. I'll let you take this.
Paul was just asking. He has an SBA loan that he had an authorization, and the authorization was dated in September. Well, that authorization, the time to pay the guarantee fee, actually would have expired December 24th. At that point, SBA sends you a letter and says you got X number of days to get it done. And Paul says the loan's not ready to close, and he's wondering if he could collect the guarantee fee up front and go ahead and close in a month or two. Well, the SOP states that you can charge the guarantee fee after the initial disbursement, which would indicate that if you collect the guarantee fee from the borrower and then pay it to SBA, you're not following the SOP as it should be. You need to go ahead as a bank and pay that guarantee fee. Because right now with the government shutdown, you certainly don't want to lose the loan and have to go back and put it back in. So as a bank, pay the guarantee fee when you close the loan, make that initial disbursement, which remember, guys, you cannot make the initial disbursement cannot just be for the guarantee fee. Make an initial disbursement, then charge the guarantee fee and collect it, and then come out of loan proceeds as long as your use of proceeds indicates a piece for the guarantee fee. But, Paul, you need...
By the way, Oakrum is looking at that to see the timing. That's one of those little gotcha moments.
Yeah. So, Paul, use bank money. When you close it, disperse it, collect it from the borrower.
All right, Kim, you're up. I'm going to ask this question to you. And we have a question from Vernon that says, I have a client going through a divorce does that automatically disqualify her for an SBA loan until it is settled? Her attorney is asking for some type of language. I know that's you probably haven't done that, but how would you approach that?
Well, that's an interesting scenario for sure, and it does come up. So we would look first to see if she's already part of the operating business.
It's her company. She's 100%
owned company.
Her company.
And if she has ownership in that company, I think the biggest rule that would come up first is this six-month rule we have, that a change of ownership, if it happens, we have to wait 6 months. And if it means they would no longer give a personal guarantee, that's when we would have that six-month rule come into effect. I mean, we're going to work with borrowers. It's life. Yeah. It happens. And
the question is, does not disqualify her. If she's the owner, we can do something. If they're separating it out, I love the advice in 6 months. Hey, we're running out of time. Thank you. And let's see real quick. We have a question from Linda. How are maximum loan amounts calculated? Is it based on affiliation, regardless of whether the principal has any guarantee? I guess we're talking about if we have a number of different companies that have, let's say we have two different companies with two different SBA loans. What do we do on that, Kim? Just add them together?
Well, when you have affiliate companies, Bob, they're going to look at the loan total for all the affiliate companies, right, and determining the maximum loan amount. So, Kim, I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. That was a great answer, Lance.
I mean, that's one of the things that you have to be careful with, guys, because I dealt with one the other day, and they gave me their full list of so-called affiliate businesses. And as we did a deeper dive, we found there was yet another affiliate that did have an existing SBA loan. So that's a question that needs to be vetted very carefully when you've got somebody with multiple ownership positions in businesses.
Very good.
And I will just throw in quickly that it's not just percentage of ownership, but it's also about control.
Yeah.
So we want to look for both those things in affiliates.
Very good. These are the secondary market quotes. We publish those weekly for both 504 and 7A. Let's quickly go to the compensation. We're going to cut that off at the end of the month. So please, if you want a free copy, go to our website and we will send you your compensation for your bucket list. And these are some of our upcoming webinars. Lance, you're doing a review of what we should be doing for 2019. Hey, Opportunity Zone Funds, we're going to announce this tomorrow. It's very interesting. We're going to do a webinar on that next month. And those are some of the other future offerings that we have. Tom, I got your question. I'm going to hold that over to next week. We'll talk about that. If anybody of you have questions during the week, please do that. What I will do next week is I'll try to come up with a better list of bridge loan lenders and what their appetite is for both 7A and 504. Brent, Kim, Lance, thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you next week. Thank you.
Thank you.